There's one particular visual effect that you've probably seen in hundreds of classic films, but it's so cleverly done that you probably never even realized it was there. They've created some of your favorite worlds, and they're almost as old as cinema itself. So, I'm Steve from Unexplored Films, and today we are talking about matte paintings, and how you can recreate this classic Hollywood effect in your own films. So matte paintings were traditionally used by Hollywood to allow filmmakers to create the illusion of an environment that could not be present at the filming location. By expertly blending live-action footage with still images, filmmakers became masters of creating worlds that would be impossible or just too expensive to film for real. Traditionally, matte paintings were made by painting images on large sheets of glass, and areas would be left blank for the live-action footage to appear through. Some of Hollywood's most famous matte paintings were made by Industrial Light and Magic for the classic Star Wars and Indiana Jones films, where they massively increase the scale of the action and are so good that you rarely realize you're looking at paintings. To create these shots, the areas of live action would be filmed first. The matte painter could use these shots for reference and then extend the scene onwards into something that couldn't be filmed for real. Then the paintings would be shot by film cameras with a black screen covering the gaps. Then the live shots would be projected into the gaps, and the film would be wound back and another pass would be shot. Some of the best matte painting shots trick your brain into thinking the whole shot is moving by including enough small areas of movement so that you don't notice the still areas. As filmmaking evolved, traditional matte paintings were basically replaced by digital compositing technology. And although they're not technically paintings anymore, lots of modern films still use the same techniques to build extra scenery and extend their worlds. Matte painting shots often work especially well as scene setters, and then you cut in closer for all the dialogue. And you can use similar techniques to build your world on a budget. So like a lot of the effects I teach, this is just another way to try and tell your story using what may already be available to you. And if you're enjoying these DIY Hollywood effects tutorials, please subscribe, and as always, you will get to see some more. So I'm going to run through two versions of this effect, an easy version and a difficult version, and the main difference between the two is that the easy version is a static shot where the camera doesn't move, and the difficult version is a shot that moves. And if you want to see some of these techniques being used on a miniature scale, check out my video for adding set extensions to miniatures. So for the first example, we started by getting this static shot of me looking at a landscape, and we made sure that my head didn't look like it was above the horizon. And I opened this in Premiere, which is where I do most of my editing. Now you can actually do this entire process within Premiere or whatever edit program you're using if it has a good mask tool, but I decided to build this first option in Photoshop because I think it gives you the most control if you're using static images and you're trying to cut them out and blend them together. So because I was going to work on this in Photoshop, I first exported a still frame of the shot in Premiere. So nowadays, of course, rather than painting, we can use real photos. So a good site to try is Unsplash, which is a great resource for finding copyright-free images that people have been kind enough to share. Or alternatively, you can just go onto Google Images and change the usage rights menu to labeled for reuse. So for this matte painting, I decided I wanted to build a castle sitting on top of a mountain ridge, because hey, it's more interesting than the landscape that was actually there. So I opened up my freeze frame and my mountain image in Photoshop, and I firstly lined up the mountain on top of the freeze frame in what I thought looked like a good position. And it helps to drop your opacity to 50% just so you can see where it's lining up, which you can do with the slider on the right, or you can hit 5 on your keyboard for 50. Once I was happy with the mountain's position, I could grab my quick selection tool, and this did a pretty good job of selecting the mountain. If it struggles with a difficult edge, you can always drop your brush size down to make it smaller. And if you hold down Alt, you can remove parts of the selection that it might have selected by mistake. I just added some of the trees in beneath it as well. Now we can come down to the bottom right and select Add Layer Mask. This means it will now display just the part we have selected, but it won't delete the rest of the pixels just in case we need them. Then I made sure I had the layer mask selected, and I grabbed the brush tool. If you right-click, you can change the size and the hardness to something that you want, and you will get a black and a white square as your foreground and background color. You can toggle between these using the X key. If you have black selected, you can paint out parts of the mask that you don't want, and if you have white selected, you can paint parts back in. This meant I could now do a nice subtle join between the real scenery and the fake scenery, and by changing the size and the hardness of the brush when I needed to, I was able to make some details less feathered than others. And this is such a good way of combining layers because it is non-destructive editing. We're not permanently deleting anything in case we still need it. And if you alt-click on the layer mask at any time, you will get to see what the mask is actually looking like in the black and the white colors. This can be really helpful if you've accidentally missed some areas. Once I was fairly happy with the blend of the scenery, I could then control and click on the layer mask to select it, and come down to the bottom to add an adjustment layer. This now means the adjustment layer will only tweak the settings over this part of the image. And I began with hue and saturation just to dull down the colours of the mountain a bit, and that blended a bit better. Next, I could repeat the same process with my castle image. So I think this was a Scottish castle which I'm now putting on top of an Italian mountain, so Scots and Italians, you both have better scenery than I do. Now this is quite a quick example and I didn't spend much time on it, but really you should be using footage and still images that all have lighting directions that match. Because the light hitting the mountain is coming from the right and the light hitting the castle is coming from the left, I did right click and flip horizontal to make the castle face the other way to match the mountain. I thought the mountain looked a little strange on its own, so using the same techniques I built a whole mountain range behind it. And don't forget, for objects that are further away, those are probably going to look lighter and hazier and have less contrast. I'd also suggest adding some blur if your subject is in the distance and if that's what your original footage looks like. Now, if this was a traditional matte painting in an old film, you would probably just have to have the clouds not moving, but of course we can use our real sky. So if we also cut out our sky right down to the horizon, we can now save this with a transparent area behind the mountain. So you can either save this as a Photoshop image, as a PSD, but this is going to be very large, so you might prefer to save it as a PNG file, and your edit program and computer might find that much easier to work with. So next we can go back to Premiere and we can drop in the still image over the top of our footage. Next you can use the pen tool within Premiere to actually mask out the area of the image that you don't want. So now we're seeing areas of movement and the rest of the image that we have added is of course our matte painting. And because we cut out the sky as well, we are actually seeing the real clouds rolling past. And as long as you don't step into the area of the frame that you shouldn't, nobody should really be able to see the join. And then perhaps with some color correction, we get a pretty nice basic matte painting example. So that's the basic technique for adding a matte painting element into a static shot. Now, of course, you don't have to add something into the distance or on the horizon. You could, in fact, add something into the foreground, like I tried here with this Indiana Jones style shot. And another idea to try is to replace the view out of your window. And if you never walk in front of the window, this is a really nice effect to experiment with. All these ideas are basically just relying on saving a freeze frame, doing your changes in Photoshop, bringing the still back into your editing program, and then just masking out the areas to leave the movement. Finally, if you really think this is too static and you want to add some movement to it, you can keyframe it manually or use a handheld preset. So here's the slightly more complicated version of this effect. Let's say you want to do a real camera move on the day and composite your matte element in later. So to demonstrate this, I got this footage tilting up from the motorway to reveal the horizon behind. The trees are moving, the camera's moving, and we want to retain all of that real movement. So if you open the clip in After Effects, we can click on Track Camera, and this is going to work out all the 3D movements of our shot. Now, if you're going to try and put a matte painting into a moving image, it's better just to do a pan or a tilt or something where you're standing in one place while filming. You really just want to be filming from a fixed position. So we can tell After Effects that this is the kind of shot that we are making it analyze. Because if we go into this Advanced tab, we can change Auto Detect to Tripod Pan. And we can also tick Detailed Analysis as well, and that doesn't do any harm. So now After Effects goes through and analyzes the clip and gives you this whole bunch of tracking markers. So if you check it and see if it's worked and you're happy with it, you can click on Create Camera. And that is going to create this layer called 3D Tracker Camera, which has saved all of the data. What's even better is that you can select some of these points for where you want your object to appear, and if you right-click, you can create a null instantly, which will stick to that area. And this is brilliant for this effect, because the null is the thing that we are going to attach our mountaintop castle to. So I just brought in the castle layer, and that is going to be a 2D layer, so the first thing you need to do is to turn on the 3D effect, because we are going to be attaching this to a 3D null. So if we just turn that on, we are now going to parent it to the null, and if we hold down Shift, it will translate all of the attributes of the null as well. So now if we play through, we can see that the mountain and the castle are sticking in exactly the right place, but what we do need to do is to make it appear like it's behind the horizon and these trees. Now we can use the contrast here between the dark trees and the light sky to our advantage. So if we duplicate our background motorway layer over the top, we can then just add a luma key. And if we select key out brighter instead of key out darker, we can just move the values around until we're basically seeing a really nice edge of those trees. Now obviously this doesn't get it right everywhere, but this means that we can just mask out the areas of this layer that we're not going to use, and just use the area where the trees meet the mountain base. You can see that now the trees are in front and they are moving. So we're not doing any dodgy freeze frame trees where the live action meets the still elements. Now you can add other things to the same null and they should all move together, like this stormy sky which I took from another shot, and there is the colour corrected final shot of the castle sitting on the mountain above the motorway, and it completely matches the movement of our camera. So hopefully those examples give you some pretty good ideas about how you can recreate some classic techniques seen in old Hollywood map paintings and use them in your own films. And if you enjoyed this one, why not drop a comment below about what Hollywood effect you would like to see recreated next? I have been Steve from Unexplored Films, and I'll see you next time.